Okay, excellent. So in the last class, we discussed these exact renormalization proof equations. We explained how the renormalization proof can be thought of as a flow of infinite number of parameters. Most of these parameters are irrelevant. Are parameters of the sort that would just flow to zero under classical scale transformations. And the quantum version of that statement we understood plausibly turned out to be that the renormalization group equations tend towards some sort of fixed plane or some fixed hypersurface of some dimensionality. The irrelevant parameters were not zero on the hypersurface, but were determined by the relevant parameters. Okay? So the net conclusion of that was that it allowed quantum field theory to be predictive, because it allowed a few parameters to mask our ignorance of what was happening in the UV, okay, and to completely characterize all measurements below a certain infrared scale. Any questions or comments about the general philosophy, the general structure of the equations? Yes, at least in perturbation theory that's true. But it's always true once we look at the relevant and marginal operators around the infrared phase. But these are the same as the relevant marginal operators around the ultraviolet fixed point in perturbation theory. Because in perturbation theory, nothing can change very much. Okay. Non-perturbatively, outside perturbation theory, these might be quite different things. We'll see examples. Okay?
We can argue that all these relevant parameters will ultimately at a particular stage be determined in terms of a few relevant parameters. But how about non-renormalizability of the equation? Does the non-convergence to a specific surface imply inability to find out and not a G0 as functions of the high scale cutoff level?
You want to know what does it mean for a theory to be non-renormalized?
Exactly.
All right. Good. So see, suppose we had a fixed point, okay, such that there were, I'll give you an example. Suppose we had a fixed point such that it had no relevant operators, no relevant marginal operators. All operators were irrelevant. Okay? So the flows to this fixed point look like this. Suppose you started at any point here, okay, and you let the renormalization group flow for an infinite amount of time. Okay, as long as you're in the basin of attraction of this fixed point, you will always reach here. Okay. Now, this is the kind of situation we have. Okay. Now, in simple examples, this theory is just a free theory. A simple example of this is the theory of gravity. Okay? Where in the theory of gravity, every operator that you add around the free fixed point of just del H, okay, is high dimension. And so at least plausibly about fixed point, certainly in perturbation theory, fixed point, is relevant. Okay, now, the issue is the following. You see, now suppose, since there is no, there's a fixed point, which is a distinguished point, and then there's this infinite dimensional space. So, if you want to make a theory, so the theory of gravity was just an example, this is a question. Okay. So now suppose you want to make a theory of this fixed point, that's easy. You just start somewhere in the UV, you flow for an infinite amount of time, and you get to the fixed point. Okay. However, suppose you wanted to make a theory that was deformed away from this fixed point. Okay? If you had ultimate, you know, exquisite control, you could perhaps, this depends on details, But you could perhaps engineer some renormalization group flow that would end up, let's say here, after a very large amount of flow. Technically after an infinite amount of flow, if you, you know, keep going up that trajectory. Okay, so you're starting at scale lambda naught, you are at scale lambda, and if there is a flow that does not degenerate in some way, if you go to the UV, you go for an infinite amount of distance, then you could take lambda naught to infinity, moving along that curve, so that you always end up here. But the point being here, that if you want to get to any particular point here, you have to do an infinite amount of fine-tuning in the UV. You see, because there is nothing particularly distinguished about this point. You could as well land up at this point, or that point, or any other point. Okay? Given that there are an infinite number of irrelevant directions away from this fixed point. Okay? So if you started at some random point in the UV, you could perhaps try to engineer things so that as you were in the UV, you moved further and further in the UV as you took lambda not to infinity. You could perhaps try to engineer things so that you don't end up right at the fixed point. But then, unless you had exquisite control over what was going on, you wouldn't know where you were going to end up. You could perhaps engineer things so that you end up in the neighborhood of this fixed point. But you wouldn't know where in the neighborhood you're going to end up, unless you had fantastic control over what was going on. Let me distinguish this from the situation where there is some sort of fixed plane. Where there was this distinguished fixed plane. Okay? If you started in the UV, no matter where you started in the UV, you would end up on this plane. The analog of that here was that no matter where you ended up starting in the UV, unless you did something very crazy, you would end up at this point. The point is not difficult to get to. But if you want to get some theory that is in the neighborhood of the point. Okay? There's an infinite number of such theories, none of which are particularly distinguished.
Sir, but if you're in the neighborhood, eventually you'll go to the center, right?
You will go to the center. But suppose you're trying to arrange, so that suppose we have got some genome here, and this is lambda. Okay? Such that this flow is arranged so that you reach here, suppose, at scale lambda. Now you could ask, can I instead try to get a renormalization group flow that will reach the same point as lambda naught goes to infinity? This is not totally impossible. You could imagine doing this by taking, you know, but as I change lambda naught, I move around this trajectory. You understand? Okay? You could imagine trying that. Actually, but it could be that this curve will degenerate and hit infinity at some point. So it's not possible. This is possible. But it could be that it would work. Let's leave open the possibility that it will work. Okay? Then, you could imagine some sort of renormalization group flow that would end up here, even though we started at lambda naught equals infinity. Okay? But that would require extreme fine-tuning of where you started out in the UV. If you started out at some other point, generically, of course, you would just be here. But if you somehow tuned things so that you didn't, you were near but not. Yeah, you would go end up somewhere else. Do you understand?
Does this
mean
we are adding some relevant
operators to the UV, or we are just... Okay, always. No, yeah, right. In this particular case, we'd have to add all kinds of operators. If you want to stay around on this particular, it would be some crazy UV. Okay? So, you see, this is what a non-trivial, this is the statement of non-trivial. You see, when you've got a fixed point that apparently has no marginal or relevant deformations around it, then flows to that fixed point are, of course, very easy to organize. You start almost anywhere you get to that fixed point. But sometimes that fixed point itself is trivial. This is like the case of gravity. That fixed point is trivial. Okay? Now, it's easy to get to that fixed point, but we're not interested in that fixed point because we don't live in a theory with free gravity. Okay? So what you want to do is to get to the neighborhood of the fixed point, where some deformations are turned on. And the key point about non-renormalizability is that there is no distinguished, there's an infinite number of directions in the neighborhood of the fixed point. There's no distinguished point at which you live. See, the statement that neighborhood of that fixed point is not in any way distinguished. That's the key point. Is this clear? So suppose you wanted to try to make, you know, suppose it made sense to do, you know, so gravity is, has many subtleties. But let's suppose we took four-foot theory. We've got a theory of some number of fermions.
Let's say U1.
Yeah. And you wanted to make a theory where the interaction was side by side, side by side. At least in perturbation theory, this is an irrelevant interaction. Okay? Because in four dimensions, the operator psi as the field psi is classical dimension 3 halves. Okay? This is classical dimension 6. So this is like the X6 coupling that we talked about in our discussion of the exact composition. Okay? So classically this just damp stuff. Okay. Now, so there is of course a fixed point in this theory. Theory free scalar fields. The fact that every operator around it is irrelevant tells you that the flow diagram in the neighborhood of this point looks like this. This in fact is an exact statement because the fixed point is free. So we know that it's not some statement in perturbation theory. It's just a true statement. Okay? Because once you reach this point itself, it's going to be clear. So to construct the renormalization root flow equations in its neighborhood. Okay? So, now this is the issue. Now suppose you wanted to make this theory, whatever it means. Okay? Suppose you started with this particular... So what you might want to do is the following. You might want to start with a theory, and some g0 times psi bar psi, psi bar psi. You can do this and try to choose g0 to be a function of lambda. Okay? But because there's no fixed plane, if you do this in a way to hold g at lambda fixed, where g is the coefficient of the same operator at scale lambda, like we did for the Python formula. If you do it, and you choose g0 of lambda naught so as to hold g of lambda fixed, perhaps you can achieve this. Okay? But the second part of the theorem that we proved, namely that the coefficient of all other operators will have a smooth lambda not goes to infinity limit, will not be true. You see, because what you're doing is this. You're starting from along different trajectories. And there's no, yeah, so suppose we've got this. Since there's no convergence, convergence only to the point, but not. So suppose we've got a flow that looks like this, and another flow that looks like this. Say we choose an RG flow, RG scale, flow, so that this guy is fixed. So we start from here, we did enough flow time, so we got here. Okay? Now, here we flow enough so that we get here. These two theories, so you understand what I mean? This is like, let's say this was G6, this was G8. Okay? These two theories will, in the Wilsonian cutoff sense, in the exact renormalization sense, have equal G6 by construction. Okay? Because, let's call this G6. Well, G6 is a 6 dimension. Okay. Like equal G6 by construction, but they will have different values of G8 and different values of G10 and different values of G12. There's no reason to suppose that they will not. Because we do not have this fact that all flows tend to a constant flow size. You understand this? Okay?
Yeah, but in this case also we have this mass parameter and not of lambda naught. Yes. So can't we adjust it to a one parameter?
We could, but that's still a free theory of free massive fermions.
So it's like a one parameter set of
fixed. A free theory of one parameter set. Well, it's not quite fixed points because you see the mass parameter is massive. So more precisely what's going on is there is a one-dimensional relevant definition, which is the mass pattern. Okay? It's easy to land on this surface. But this one-dimensional relevant deformation is a one-dimensional relevant deformation of three theories. Suppose we're doing chiral fermions, okay? So that we wouldn't have the mass pattern. Just keep things simple. Just to keep things conceptually simple. That's remarkable. Then it's exactly the same. Okay. Is this very clear? Yes.
How does this contribute to the infinities
look at? How does the contribute to the infinities look at? Very, very good. You see, the point here is that we can adjust where we started from here in order to set G4 fixed. Which means that if we compute 4-point scattering by this choice, maybe by construction we have something fine. Okay? On the other hand, we have not managed to set G6 fixed. Therefore, when we get this off to infinity, in general, this G6 quantity, as lambda not goes to infinity, will diverge. Okay? Now we could try to fix that. How can we try to fix that? We might try to say, well, instead of starting with a bare Lagrangian until lambda naught and G6 naught, let me choose G6 and G8 naught. Or whatever, 6 points Kenton, whatever that is. 6 into 3 by 2. 8, 9. Okay. So we could try to choose these bare values so that we will fix G6 to a particular value, G9 to a particular value in the ion. Great, we can do that. But then G12 will diverge. And then we will have to do the same thing. And it will go on forever. You see?
But when we write a bare Lagrangian,
yes.
We are writing it in the UV, right?
We are writing it in the UV.
So we already have all the knots fixed.
No. So the philosophy we had for renormalization was, let's remember what the Puchinsky proof was. That we could choose G0, in that case, for phi to the 4 theory, we could choose G0 as a function of lambda naught. So we choose G0 as a function of lambda naught, so that G4 at lambda stays fixed. In perturbation theory that you can do, this is more or less obvious. Because the leading order G0 is G4. And then there are small corrections. Okay, so it's more or less obvious that you can do this. The point about flowing to this fixed surface was that once you do this, the full Lagrangian at scale lambda naught is determined. Sorry, full Lagrangian at scale lambda is determined in the limit lambda naught goes to infinity. Okay? That was renormalization. Renormalizability. That was the fact that if you that it was possible to choose G0 as a function of lambda. So that G4 is held fixed. And once that's done, everything else is also held fixed. Has a good limit. Okay? So then you get theories labeled by what your G4 is. That's a parameter. But once you fix that parameter, everything else is held fixed. Is this clear? Okay? On the other hand, in this situation, when we choose G6 not as a function of lambda naught, to try to hold G6 fixed, we presumably can do this. But G9 is not fixed. In fact, would diverge in general as we took lambda naught. G9 at scale lambda would in general diverge as we took lambda naught to infinity. Am I being completely clear?
So when you're using this G6 and not, are you using some empirical information?
Like, empirical? You see?
Like, because the scattering, you're looking at the 4-point scattering.
Yeah. We're fixing it in terms of two free parameters. Sorry, in terms of, in this case, one free parameter, namely G4 at scale lambda. Then, to know how that theory fits to a particular experimental situation, you will tune that parameter, G4 at scale lambda, to match experiments.
So, you imagine.
Right. Okay. But before we do that, let's just see how we can produce parameter sets of consistent theories. And then we can choose those parameters to match against experiment. let me say this again because it's a very important question. Okay, let me say this again. First, reminding you. Okay, looks like we're going to have 3 or 4 lectures on the normalization, which is great. Just not what I expected. This is great. Okay, so let me remind you what we showed in the case of the functional composite. Where we started with the Lagrangian, which is del phi over n squared plus m naught squared as a function of lambda naught phi squared plus g naught to the 4 as a function of lambda naught. We started with this bare Lagrangian. Okay? Or we started with the renormalization, exact renormalization group equations. With the Lagrangian at scale lambda, not given by this. Okay? Then, we wanted to look at theories. Such that at scale lambda, the phi to the 4 coupling was some g of 1. The term with no momentum. The phi to the 4 was g of 1. At scale lambda, we've got a very complicated Lagrangian. It has all kinds of momentum dependencies for 4 phi couplings. It has 6 phi couplings with all kinds of momentum. A large infinity of number of parameters at scale lambda. Okay? But we put only one constraint. We put one constraint that at some at fixed lambda, g of lambda was something fixed. Let's call it g. Now, what does that mean? You see, suppose you see this condition was true when we started with this theory. We started with this theory, and we also put the other condition that m of lambda was fixed. Let's add something. Let's call it a. Now, suppose this condition was true for some. For some m naught of lambda naught and g naught of lambda. Now the point is we wanted to change lambda. We wanted to increase lambda naught. Okay? So as we change lambda naught, if we didn't change m naught, we kept m naught and g naught fixed, then these two conditions would no longer be true. But now we have two conditions and two things to adjust. The two things to adjust are n naught of lambda naught and g naught. Okay? Since we're doing infinitesimal, it's a linear equation, so we can always do that adjustment. So we can always find trajectories, n naught of lambda naught and g naught of lambda. These trajectories are tuned so that these two conditions are always met. And some fixed scale lambda, let's call this lambda of interest. This is just held fixed. We're changing lambda naught, keeping lambda fixed. Then, because of this convergence property, because the renormalization group flows at least in perturbation theory, at this structure, it's a convergence structure. Where the MC say forward. Once we do this and we take this off to infinity, once we met these conditions, all other parameters at scale lambda also are not changed as we change lambda. Okay? The key point here was the convergence of these rules. Okay? If the flows on the other hand had been like this, we could have always made these two conditions. These conditions could always have been true. Okay? But the conclusion, the result, that G6, the G8, and so on were all fixed. And a good lambda not good infinity would not be true. Okay? So now, suppose we're in that situation. We're in this psi to the 4 theory rather than phi to the 4. Okay? Because G6 is not true, we would do the analog of this. Let me write it up. Because G6 is not fixed, we've got this G6 of psi, we've got G6 of psi to the 4 plus G9 of psi to the 6, and so on. And just for simplicity, we've already made it. There's also G8, which is 2 derivatives of psi. There's an infinite number of things. Doesn't matter, the details don't matter. we could try to choose this as a function of lambda naught and increase our scope, this as a function. Now we've got one more thing to play with. So we can arrange for instance, G9 at scale lambda to be held fixed. Held fixed to what value? To any value we want. What have we done? We've ensured that 9-point scattering with that zero momentum part, 9-point scattering will be finite. But we've not ensured that 12-point scattering will be finite. I mean, not 6-point scattering, which is dimensional. 6-point scattering will be finite, but we've not ensured that 8-point scattering will be finite. To do that, we would also have to include a G12 as a function lambda, and so on. So we would have to put an infinite number of parameters in our bare approach. Now that in itself is not a disaster. But the point is, each time you put a new parameter, you also put a new renormalization condition. Which is, you also add a new parameter in your theory. Because you say, here, our theories were labeled by two parameters. All this was smoke and mirrors. Again, this is how we constructed it. But the final parameters in the two theories were G and F. Okay? Now, if in addition to this guy, we also choose this guy as a function of lambda naught, we will have to say, put another condition. You know, at scale lambda, the 6.6 psi term was some value. So we could get a new parameter in the theory. Okay? It's a general fact that for each adjustment you do in the infrared, you have a new parameter in the infrared. Since you didn't have to do an infinite number of adjustments in the infrared, you'll have infinite number of parameters in your theory. Okay? And this now is simply this diagram. That you can be away from this fixed point, but there's an infinite number of directions in which you can be away. And there's nothing distinguished over into the continuum. So there are, the statement that you are a little bit away from the fixed point carries very little information. Because you have to say in which direction. And specifying that in which direction are these infinite number of parameters. Okay? Is this clear? Yes.
So, as we did in this case, we have fixed k0 and q0, and then we have decreased it and we remove all the parameters and don't use these parameters because we have fixed surface and
yes.
But why can't we do it in that case?
Because there was no fixed surface. No, nothing to do with it. Because the flow is not of this form. You see, what is the flow like? In this case, the flow is like this. Then you start, let's say here, you go like this, start from here, you go like that. So if you fix G0, some scale, if you fix G6, you don't fix G0. It's because the flows don't approach it. That is the main thing. If you've got these attractive flows, then you're fine. Okay, is this clear?
So statements like 1-6 theory in coordination is not normalization. We find them in textbooks.
Yes. No, they have meaning, clear meaning in this context. Suppose, you see, like what does that statement mean? That statement means, see, let's first talk about perturbation. We're going to today talk, go away from perturbation. Let's restrict ourselves to perturbation. Okay? So, suppose we had, you see, this is 5-6 theory in 4 dimensions, is the renormalization group's flows we studied with Bulchinski. Okay? So that has this structure. Okay? So we have some G4, and there is the G6's converged region. Now, what do we do? You see, if anything reasonable we do in the ultraviolet always leads us to this fixed surface. But you remember in the last class we discussed one thing that sounds reasonable but is actually unreasonable physically. That one can do that will not take you to this fixed surface. That is just to scale our X6 as lambda naught square. You see, because the convergence was like a 1 over lambda square. So if you scale x6 in the inverse of that, then there isn't enough time in the flow for you to reach the fixer. So then, if you do that, you will not reach this fixed surface, you can build somewhere. But once again, the point is the following. That while the fixed surface is distinguished, deviations from it are not. So there are infinite number of ways in which you can deviate from it. So if you try to, you know, this attempt, this 5 to the 6 is non-renormalized. What does it mean? What it means is, we will try to adjust the coupling constant in the union of the 5 to the 6 operator. In such a way that it will affect the 5 to the 6 coupling at scale. In order to do that, we need to choose our x6 knot to scale like lambda not square. But fine, nobody stopped. It's a free world, nobody can stop you from doing that. So you do it. That's great. But the point is, this does not then uniquely define a thing. Meaning that this, if you now do this and try to take the lambda not goes to infinity limit, you will not have a good definition of the theory. Because by deviating, you deviate in some direction. Now you force that direction to have the x6 of a particular value. But you don't control the x8 or the x10. And then you take lambda from to infinity, those in general will diverge. Okay? So the general point is this, that flows to a fixed surface, you know, are controlled. Deviations away from it are wild. See, quantum field theory has an infinite number of directions in which you can go, but a finite number of marginal relatives, you know, is fixed. Okay? So if you're willing to do the natural thing and flow to this fixed kind of thing, you're fine. If you try to go away from it, all hell breaks loose. Have you understood this? The really important point is not the claim that there is no consistent theorem here. That is not the claim. The claim is that while there is a consistent theory, while there might well be a consistent theory, okay, you will not be able to reach any particular point without specifying an infinite number of parameters. Doing an infinite amount of times. Is this totally clear? Okay? Fine. Any other questions? Yes?
So the fact that we have fixed surface, where G6, G8 are all are fixed in terms of G1 and G4.
Yes.
Are these values of G6, G8 like, is it in terms of our old final diagram, this thing, is it saying that we can just find the 6-point function by taking 4-point vertices and nothing else?
Right. It is saying that if you work in the theory, in the ultraviolet theory, you take 4-point vertices and nothing else, and you get the right answer to the 6-point. But it's saying one other thing. It's saying that, you see, the problem with that is that you get a uniquely determined 6-point vertex. That's obvious. What's not obvious is that it converges. It has a good lambda not goes to infinity. That statement, the fact that the ultraviolet theory completely determines the 6-point vertex, and that it's finite, okay, is the content of this. Okay? You see, let's say again, you see, what quantum field theory has been defined as a limit. As a limit of lambda naught goes to infinity. For any particular lambda naught, of course you have a uniquely determined 6-point scattering. But the question is, how do you know the lambda naught goes to infinity limit exists? And this is not a vacuous worry, because if you do things naively, it does not exist. If that limit exists, then of course it is unique. So these two statements are equivalent. The statements that flow lines converge, and the statements that all correlators have good lambda not goes to infinity limits are equivalent statements.
Okay. So I was worrying over a different thing. You never have to worry about the fact that G6, G8 are all
generated.
Are all non-zero on the fixed surface.
Yes, we never have to worry about that. Because you see how, because it's a fixed surface, we want to get to this fixed surface.
Yeah.
We start in the UV with, let's look at this fixed surface as two parameters, M and G. If we start in the UV with the Lagrangian that has any two parameters, put two renormalization conditions, we will hit the same point on the fixed surface. Okay? So a convenient choice of two parameters for the UV Lagrangian is M naught and G naught. Because we need to adjust two parameters to get where we want the fixed surface. Okay? That's why we know that. But you know, suppose you had wanted to. Nobody could have stopped you from it. It would be fine. To start with M0, G0, and G6 determined as some arbitrary function. That's more appropriate. X6 determined by some arbitrary function of X2 naught and X1. That would also have worked and would have led you to the same. Because of the convergence. So there's nothing particularly sacrosanct about starting with those that you'd be like the Lagrangian. But there's nothing wrong with it. Like, just because it has the right number of parameters. Is this completely clear? Very good question. Very good question. So, excellent question. So the question is that we're constructing quantum field theory in this mathematical operation that demands lambda not going to infinity. And this is very nice, but the question is this mathematics or is it physics? You see, because in any real physical situation, you would expect some new physics at some finite scale. And then you can't take lambda. This is exactly correct. So quantum field theory, the way I'm trying to set it up, is useful only when there is a significant separation of scales between the physics that you want to measure and the scale of new physics. Okay? Everything that we do will be corrected. Because you will not have had, if you don't quite start at lambda not equals infinity, you will not quite have time to reach the fixed surface. So there will be corrections to everything. But these corrections, you see, will be suppressed by lambda naught, lambda by lambda naught to some power. In our case, lambda by lambda naught square. So if lambda by lambda naught is large enough, what we do can be a pretty good approximation to what happens in the lambda. Is this clear? This is one of the reasons why, so far, quantum field theory has been an extremely useful tool in particle physics. Because, just experimentally, it has been the case that there have been very large separations of scales in particle physics. Okay, so, for instance, suppose we looked at QED. QED was an excellent theory for many processes. What's the mass scale for QED? The mass of the electron. Okay, or maybe if you apply it to atomic physics, the mass of the proton, or whatever, some scale that involves electron volts or maybe 1,000 electrons. Okay? Now, QED is not a complete theory. Okay, it's embedded in the standard model. But where is that this embedding happen? It happens at the weak scale. In the scale of the W bosons, which is considerably higher, by several orders of magnitude, to the scale of the mass of the electron. That separation of scales is what underlies the excellent functioning of QED as an autonomous theory, without worrying about its embedding in the center. Okay? And so on. So, you see, as we've emphasized before, this separation of scales is both a blessing and a curse. It's a blessing because it allows you to do things part by part. But it's a curse because once you've understood your low energy theory, like QED, now you want to understand the next level of theory. because the imprint of what's happening at high energies is very low at low energies. That's very difficult. So the way we actually did it was building accelerators that went up to these high energies, not by studying small, subtle deviations. This lambda not by lambda squared. Okay? And this is what is hampering us in the search for new physics. Okay? In the NHC, as all of you know, we're all desperately hoping that something truly interesting, no serious theorist comes to the Higgs as truly interesting, okay, that shows up at NHC. I mean, Higgs is very interesting, but it was very interesting 40 years ago. It's not new physics. You know, it's great that it was found. Some great triumph of human intellect, blah, 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 blah. But what did it teach you that you didn't really, in some sense, very deeply suspect to be true? You know, when I was a PhD student, I learned about the Higgs particle in the 1990s. Without, you know, it was not stated as a very flaky conjecture. The model is presented as the truth. Okay, now what we found from the Higgs is we found the mass of the Higgs. That's a great thing. Having explicit numbers. But fine, it's not really new. We want new physics. New physics would be something we did not know or that we perhaps suspected, but was too flaky a suspicion to go into textbooks. Okay. So we're really hoping that we will see new physics at the LHC. Would have been really nice if we could see the new physics without having to go to very high energies. Okay? But it's very difficult because of these suppressions. You think because experiments in the end are best. Backgrounds and so on. You put out small deviations in a clean way and stuff. Okay. Good, excellent question. Another question about that.
So, why is
there a suppression between scale and in between there's nothing? Why is there no new physics? Apparently. See, between QED. Look.
I'm saying between two scales, and separate scales, in between there's nothing. After.
No, there's just a normalization of the flow of that same theory. You see, what do I mean by new physics? What I mean by new physics is, generally speaking, new particles. Okay? So suppose you do an RG flow, the kind of RG flow we're doing for binding the ball grid. Clearly that breaks down if there is a new massive particle in some sense. That is not captured by this RG flow because the new massive particle is not there. Okay? So this kind of RG flow cannot describe the physics until below the mass scale of this new particle. So this kind of analysis can only work in the regime where there's no new physics, meaning no new particles. It's all described by the same RG flow, is it? Okay? So, if the scales between new physics are well separated, then quantum field theory is a good description for each one of these new scales. Until perhaps you get to some fundamental limitation. Okay? Of course, there's another possibility. There's the other possibility that, you know, you will have new things happening, top, top, top. So there's no separation of scales. In which case, quantum field theory, as I said, becomes much less useful. Or maybe positively said, much more interesting. Is this clear? Okay? Other questions, comments? Excellent. So, good. So, now as we discussed in the previous class, okay, so far we've been using this crutch of perturbation theory.
So, the only way that these RG flows can, I don't see a way in which these RG flows can actually predict new physics, except for unless you see some sort of unified evaluation in some scattering diagonal. Is that not true? I mean, can you actually predict new physics from the RG flow?
Yeah, right. So if you see, if you take the RG flow, try to run to infinity. Try not to the UV.
Yeah.
That's the wrong direction. You shouldn't really be running away. But suppose you do that, and you find that at some point you hit some inconsistency.
In the flows itself, that's a question.
Yeah, in the flows. That if you take this flow, run it to infinity,
yeah,
and then you get some theory which has a problem. Okay? That would That would tell you that if you actually see the physics of this theory, low energies, something has to intervene before you get to higher energies. That would be a key. Okay, let's stop. For non-renormalizable interactions, it's a little more the same. There are these lectures by Ulchinsky on effective interactions in the early 1990s. I suggest you read them. Okay. Yeah, address questions in that. Okay. Other questions or comments? Okay, fine. So, where were we? So, you see, he said that even though much of our analysis would use the crux of perturbation theory, in the end, our strong suspicion, I mean, the structure of the exact normalization group of equation, this was non perturbative. And so we have his strong suspicion, perhaps we'll say more about this as we go along, that the RT flows always have the following structure. There's a distinguished point called the fixed point. This point is adjusted, is defined so that the flow equations leave all couplings at that. So at this scale, couplings do not flow. Yeah, this is the fixed point of the position stream of renormalization group equations. If your Lagrangian is at this point, d by d lambda of this Lagrangian is 0. Okay? And then we discussed that if this was the case, right? You remember we said that there was xn lambda which is equal to some theta n of xn in general. This was the structure of the equations. And then we linearize these equations around fixed points. Okay? We linearize these equations around fixed points and making certain plausible assumptions. We argue that we could diagonalize this action. Okay? And the eigenvalues of this diagonalization are called the scaling dimensions of operators around this fixed point. Okay, that's the definition. Scaling dimensions of operators around this fixed point are the eigenvalues of the diagonalization of these flow equations linearized over the fixed point. Okay? And the assumption we made is that, you know, based on our perturbative analysis, that of these eigenvalues, only a finite number would be either positive or zero. The rest would all be negative. Which is basically the statement of having most of your directions irrelevant. Okay? And then in the last class we studied flows around such a fixed point. So, for instance, if the number of relevant directions was zero, we got this point. Relevant to marginal directions was zero. Let's, for instance, for a moment, forget about the possibility of marginal. If there was one irrelevant direction, we got flows like this. One relevant direction for flows like this, where the x-axis was the relevant axis, the y-axis was any other axis, any of the infinite number of relevant, irrelevant directions. Okay. The y-axis was the relevant direction, and the x-axis was any of the other irrelevant directions. Thank you. Okay. Now you see, in such a situation, in this more abstract situation that we were dealing with, are there fixed planes? Okay. Are there fixed planes? And the answer is, the analog of fixed planes, or these fixed planes, the fixed planes are basically this line. You see? Because suppose you've got some renormalization group flow that leads you to the neighborhood of this point. Then these irrelevant directions in the neighborhood of this point will all damp out, leaving you to lie somewhere on this axis. Okay? So this is the non-perturbative version of what we're trying to say. Okay? Given a fixed point of the renormalization group from equations, there is a fixed plane of our general fixed surface generated by the flows that lead away from this fixed point in relevant directions. Okay? All the irrelevant directions, you know, just stay on that surface. Okay? There's no claim about, you know, what the value of these irrelevant directions. You know, this in some complex space, this could be happening at some non-trivial value of g6, non-trivial value of g8. It's not to say that x6 and x8 are zero at this point. So whatever it is. Okay? But there is this distinguished fixed surface. Okay? Quantum field theories, continuum quantum field theories, are theories along with this distinguished fixed surface. Okay? How do we define these theories? We define these theories by doing the kind of analysis we did. That is, taking as many parameters in the UV as there are relevant operators around the fixed point. Tuning these parameters in the UV so that we get to some particular value of parameters around these fixed points. And we're guaranteed by the convergent nature of the flows to this fixed surface. Okay, then all other parameters in our theories will be determined. Is this clear? The catchphrase that goes with these words is, let me repeat it. It is, quantum field theories are defined by denormalization group flows away from fixed points in marginal or relevant directions. Is the statement completely clear? If you've understood this, you've understood something very important about quantum field theory. That is, in the space of quantum field theories, there are very distinguished quantum field theories. Namely, those that live at fixed points of the renormalization group for equations. These theories have a name. They're called scale invariant, or at least four dimensions of the proof, conformal field. Okay? So these are very rare. Because, you know, generically you're not in the conformal point, you're somewhere here. Okay? But they're very distinguished, logically very distinguished in the space of quantum field theories. Because they're the mother of all quantum field theories. Okay? Quantum field theories are defined as renormalization group flows away from these distinguishments. Okay? So if you were into the game of classifying quantum field theories or trying to understand the structure of all quantum field theories, very good thing to do is to first understand all conformal fields. And then try to characterize all the flows of the field. Okay? Conformal field theories, fixed theories at the fixed point of the renormalized field group are extremely important theories. Is this clear?
So the fixed points, so that means like when we are constructing a field theory, we are starting with the Lamda-naught tending to infinity limit at the fixed point.
No, what does that mean? Say that again.
As in, so if I create a, if I have a point at some scale lambda,
yes,
which is in some relevant direction there on that y-axis,
yes,
and I start taking Lamda-naught tending to infinity limit
while holding this fixed,
yeah, this fixed point, then I'll...
Wait, this point...
Fixed. Oh, this
point. This,
yeah,
is a fixed point. And this is a point
of essentially. So the lambda not going to infinity limit would be the fixed point there for this field theory.
No, if we really started at the fixed point, we would never go away. Suppose at scale lambda not, you adjusted your Lagrangian so that at scale lambda not, whatever it was, you were at the fixed point. Firstly, it's very unlikely because a fixed point is not of your distinguished form. Say you start, you started with theories of scale lambda naught with m naught and phi naught. The fixed point in general will have all couplings. So it's very unlikely that you would actually start at scale lambda naught exactly at the fixed point. That would require great prescience, unless it was a free theory. Okay? But, so, but if you did start at scale lambda naught, okay, at exactly the fixed point, then you would never leave it. Because at any scale, if you start at a fixed point, you never leave it. Okay? What you have to, what, where you will in general start is, you know, some, you see, there are an infinite number of flows. Suppose we had exactly one minute. There's an infinite number of flows, all of which lead to this fixed line. Now, what you have to do is to do one tuning. The tuning is that once you're in it, at scale lambda, you'll be at this point. Sometimes it's quite a serious tuning. Because if you just start with a generic point, when you take lambda not to infinity, you'd go infinitely far away on this axis. We often interested in getting theories, not infinitely far away, but a finite distance. So you have to do one tuning. That's the thing, that's that one parameter that you have to choose as a function of lambda. Okay? That is not at the scale lambda not, generically not at the fixed point. But you do want tuning to be so that you will have a renormalization group flow that will reach near the fixed point before diverging. So that it doesn't go too far away in your field. Okay? I said this qualitatively, of course, quantitatively you do exactly what we said. You choose the UV parameter so that the IR parameter at scale lambda is exactly what you want. That takes care of everything. Is this clear? Completely clear? Go
ahead. The issue is this. You, unless you start on the fixture on that line, no matter what, you only have to asymptotically approach the y-axis.
Ah, but that's how quantum field theory is defined. It's defined as the limit lambda not goes to infinity.
Look at any flow.
Yes.
Like,
when
it's arbitrarily close to whatever point you picked,
it
won't be zero distance.
It won't be zero distance unless you take the limit that you've had an infinite amount of flow. You see, let's look at these equations. Okay. Suppose we've got one relevant and one infinite direction. Okay. Let's solve the beta function equations in the neighborhood of it. Okay? So let's suppose that the relevant direction is lambda r is a function of p. P is lambda divided by lambda naught by lambda. Okay, so flow to the axis. Well, first, e to the power ar, positive eigenvalue, times p, times lambda r of 0. And then there is lambda irrelevant, p. Which is e to the power minus a I r times lambda I r from 0.
So basically, if you take infinite time, you're basically on the perpendicular.
Exactly.
Right.
Now, you might have had a bug, which is a good one. Which is that, look, if you take infinite time, this is not to 0, but this is not to infinite. Okay, these two things go hand in hand, right? Because one of them is blowing down, the other is blowing up. That's why we need one tuning. The tuning is that you have to keep changing lambda r of 0. You have to tune that so that you hit this guy finite. That's the tuning of the one parameter that you need. But once you've done that, this guy is guaranteed to die. Is this clear? Good question. Not necessary. You see, if the fixed point happens to be a free fixed point, then being close to the fixed point is equivalent to being able to perturb. But there are many fixed points, and we're going to study one of them in this class, maybe next class. Okay. There are not free fixed points. Meaning, the physics of the fixed point is not that of free fixed. In which case, being close or far away from the fixed point has nothing to do with ordinary perturbation theory. Okay. You wanted to be close to the fixed point just so that you didn't have infinite velocity. You know, this parameter is a massive parameter. You don't want it to be very much. Yeah. So let me say there are two equivalent things that I want you to understand carefully that they are. The first thing is that quantum field theories are defined by Lagrangian specifier in the UV with a few renormalization conditions L fixed and the UV scale taken to infinite. The second statement is that quantum field theories are defined by flows away from fixed points in marginal or relevant locations. And your question was basically how are these two things going? And you see, the point was that if we start with a flow from the UV and we take the UV scale to infinity, then all deviation from this fixed surface, the surface generated by marginal relevant directions around the fixed point, have gone away. Therefore, these two things are equivalent scales. Okay? Let me say that again. In the space of full renormalization group flows, there are many flows that don't start at the fixed point and go in relevant directions. There are flows that approach the fixed point, you know, have a component in irrelevant direction and a component of that. This is such a flow. Nothing wrong with it. But if you take the lambda naught goes to infinity limit, you will never end up with such a flow. You will only end up on the fixed surface. What is the fixed surface in non-perturbative terms? Okay, what is the fixed surface in non-perturbative terms? In non-perturbative terms, it is the surface generated by marginal and relevant flows away from conformal fixed points. Okay? So that, in the end, is what quantum field theory is. The set of theories generated by the continuum quantum field theories. This is my definition of continuity. A set of renormalization group flows generated from fixed points along marginal or relevant directions. It's a very simple thing, but it's something most people don't understand. Okay? And it's very important to get this in your head.
How is the marginal flow taking you away from the fixed point? That corresponds to a zero identity.
Okay, we have to study I have to study marginal flows. It could be 5 minutes to talk about it. I've not yet talked about the marginal flows. Because marginal flows, there are two possibilities. Marginal flows can be either exactly marginal, in which case we don't have a fixed point, we have a fixed line. Okay? In the case that marginal flows are exactly marginal, then any point on this on this fixed surface is as good. And quantum field theories are defined as where you start on this fixed surface and which flow away from it in terms of relevance. Okay? Now, where a marginal direction is not exactly marginal, but it just is a direction such that when you take the beta function and expand it, so linear order is zero, but a quadratic order, some higher order, is not zero. Then we have more possibilities. In fact, these possibilities are realized in simple free fixed points. So we're going to study that. With that caveat. Okay. Any other questions?
Sir, currently I3 lambda are 0 so that the exponential, like the fixed point exactly coincides, the upper point exactly coincides
with the fixed point. We can. So, that's a particular example of the blue points going there. That can be done.
But does it create any problems?
No problems at all. In fact, it's the bestified theory. It's conformal field theories. Conformal field theories are beautiful. It flows away from them, have added layers of complexity. Okay? No problem at all, but it's not the most general. Okay? Other questions or comments? Go.
So, for lambda not going to infinity,
yes.
Then those two equations, I understand that okay, for irrelevant directions, that is guaranteed for it will, I mean, decrease the distance with the fixed surface, and that the upper equation will go along the relevant direction.
Yes.
But for one condition, I need to tune at the ultraviolet scale to stay close to the fixed point, right?
Absolutely.
But that, how does that guarantee that the tuning the first equation will not hamper the property of the second equation? So basically my point is, like, if I am going to tune lambda not r, lambda r not at the scale uv,
yes,
so that will somehow influencing the e to the power art behavior, right?
Yes.
If I am looking at
it's just fix, it's tuning this guy.
Yeah. So tuning the same guy, that's
very unlikely. Of course, it could be that there is a coincidence. It could be that you choose some line in your initial points, so this will happen. But it's generically very unlikely. So let's look at a flow. So you see, let's look at these flows. Okay. What do we want? You see. In fact, smaller. Okay, so yeah. For these linearized flows about this fixed point, okay, we can just do it. So let's just try to do it. Okay. So suppose we've got some scale lambda and some scale. Suppose it was true, it will in general not be true, but suppose it was true for a moment that the whole flow is in the linearized regime around the fixed point. And there were only two such. There were only two operators. Okay. Now, what is our flow defined by? Okay. Our flow is defined by lambda naught. Let's call it lambda naught IR and lambda naught UV in the ultraviolet. Okay. So suppose that at scale lambda naught, we have lambda IR and lambda. Relevant. Suppose this was true. Okay. Now we want to know, we've got some other scale lambda of interest. Okay? Suppose we've got some other scale lambda of interest. We want that at scale lambda of interest, lambda IR is some lambda. So our condition is lambda IR lambda of interest. This is our condition. Okay? So, now how do we arrange this? We can just arrange it by solving. Because this quantity here is lambda of IR, of lambda IR, lambda relevant to lambda of interest, is simply lambda naught by lambda interest to the power a IR, okay, times lambda naught. Okay? Whereas lambda UV, lambda of interest, is equal to lambda interest by lambda naught to the power a relevant, we said lambda IR. Sorry. This is irrelevant. Lambda irrelevant. So lambda and the scale limitation. Okay. This is the solution of our two equations. Okay. Now, what is the tuning that will arrange this to be held fixed? The tuning is to choose this so that this is equal to this. It says nothing about lambda relevant at scale. Okay? As long as this is held at order 1, this will just add up. Now, you see, what we actually do is something like this. You see, because what we actually do, like we did in our 5 to the 4th theorem, is choose only as many parameters in the UV theory. Choose only as many parameters in the UV theory as there were relevant directions. and I messed this up. I got it the other way around. Oh. Sorry. The relevant guy will blow up the irrelevant guy. Sorry. Okay. We have just as many parameters. So that is equivalent to tuning these guys. Generically, on our surface, okay, does not give some generic values to these guys. To have this guy not go to zero would require extra tuning, which we do not do. Is this clear? The generic behavior is that this taps out and this blows up. We do a tuning to prevent this from blowing up. There's no reason to suspect this will not tap. Because these are two different numbers. So on the one parameter set we start with, in order for both to happen, that if neither damps away, we will need in general two tunings, but we do only one. So it's an argument of genericity, but it's very plausible.
And if I tune the only the relevant one,
yes,
then the rest is defined then by the not by the condition rather but
by the
equation of the surface.
Yeah, we started with one surface. So we you know that surface is some very complicated thing in terms of, you see, I pretended here that these flows were always in the neighborhood of the fixed point. That's not true, right? Once we go to the UV, we're far away from this. So what this actually is once we start from this particular surface, given that will lead to some lambda IR and some lambda UV, effectively. Okay? So if we tune our one parameter to adjust this to be, you know, so that doesn't go up, this in general will not also happen. It will have to require some conspiracy. Now, I suppose you should keep your mind open for such conspiracies, but it's a very unlikely thing. You understand, right? Okay, other questions or comments? Go ahead.
The left-hand side lambda IR is lambda relevant at IR, and the right-hand side...
Sorry.
And the other.
Sorry. Thank you.
Sir, the
number of features
is
yes. If you've got relevant and irrelevant operators, okay, you've got to do as many fine tunings as there are relevant operators to reach the fixed point. Irrelevant operators will take care of themselves. Relevant operators are fine tuned. Is this clear? Okay, very good. Now, let's turn to the case. Now that you've got the slightly more sophisticated understanding of renormalization group first, okay? Now that we've got the slightly more sophisticated understanding of renormalization group, let us once again revisit the finding of the formula. Okay? We could ask, you know, we did this Polchinski blah 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 business. What is that stuff in terms of this fixed point? What is the fixed point? What are the relevant directions? Right? And in that case, since we're doing perturbation theory, perturbation theory. Okay, so what is perturbation? Perturbation theory is constructing quantum field theories. Okay, in the neighborhood of a fixed point. Okay, so this tells us something very interesting. You see, suppose we've got a quantum field theory, because quantum field theory is a neighborhood of a fixed point that is free. Okay, then we can very easily understand the space of relevant to marginal operators. Okay, so now we've got finding point theory. We've got the scalar field theories, and we're trying to construct a fixed point. So far, we're going to do better very soon. This is what Wilson and Fisher did. Okay, but we're going to do better. We're going to construct not free theories, but so far we're just looking at the free. Okay, so what are the operators around the free point? Well, there's the mass operator. Okay, that's x squared, y squared. And there's phi to the 4. Everything else is right. We've understood that quantum field theories are described by flows away from the fixed point in marginal or relevant directions. Okay, and we want to understand that statement in this case. We also want to understand that marginal property. Yeah? Because here we've got a marginal property, namely this phi to the 4. Okay, so what do the renormalization group flows look like? On the space of these two axes. So now I'm not drawing the irrelevant directions. Irrelevant directions damp out. We understand that very well. Forget about that. Quantum field theories are defined by flows away from the fixed point, marginal relevant directions. What are these flows? Okay, so on the x-axis, let's put the mass. This is a dimension 2 operator. Clearly, it's attractive. These flows. Now, the thing is, in the linearized theory, in the linearized level, because this is a marginal operator, okay, to leading order in this coupling, just the beta function at linearized level, it's just zero. So, in order to understand what these flows look like in the other direction, we need to go beyond linear. Okay? Now, I'm going to do a calculation for you. I thought I could do it in this class, but maybe that will be the next class, to compute what's called the beta function this time. In the next two minutes, just as to proceed, I'm going to give you the answer. Okay? And the answer is that this beta form is equal to minus some number times x squared. Remember, we're looking at flows towards the infrared. Okay, so d by dt of x four is equal to minus some number times x four squared. We compute the number in a moment. I mean, in a bit, perhaps this class, perhaps next class. We compute this number. But what's interesting about this statement? What's interesting about this statement is that if you look, it's the mass that goes away. What's interesting about this statement is that, we have to draw it. So it's attractive in these directions. So it's basically like that the flows will look sort of like this. You see? Because this guy damps out. It doesn't damp out as fast as an exponential. Now let's see how it works. Let's solve the situation. Okay, so let's see how it stands up. Let's replace this number by 1. Some number. Just complicated. Suppose this number was 1. By scaling x4, we can choose the number if we want. Okay, so what does that equation say? That's dx4 by d by x4 squared. Equal to minus d. Okay? So that's d of minus 1 by x4 is equal to minus dt. So that tells you that 1 by x is equal to d plus 1. Okay. So suppose this constant was positive. Now we take t to infinity. This takes x4 to 0. x4 is equal to 1 over t plus some constant. And x4 goes to 0 as t goes to infinity. Much slower than exponential. It's like a power law decay, but it goes to 0. Okay? So schematically, the renormalization rule flows to this. Okay. Now, in this situation, although the approach is not exponential, okay, there is basically no real difference between this operator and an irrelevant. Because it is going towards the fixed size.
With a different rate of approach from the irrelevant.
From which is a different rate of approach from the irrelevant. Okay? So in the end, okay, that this was marginal rather than irrelevant is a bit of a detail. It's an important detail for many purposes because the rate can sometimes be very important. We'll discuss this in more detail as we go. But in the end, it feels quite plausible that this is a bit of a detail. So what is quantum field theory defined by in this case? In this case, quantum field theory is just defined by this one. direction as well as this direction are effectively like relevant directions. Okay? So just like the minus sign made it effectively irrelevant, even though marginally irrelevant, the technical term is marginally irrelevant, the other sign will make it marginally relevant. And you remember that our rule was that quantum field theories are defined by flows away from fixed points in relevant directions. So this would now allow us to define a two-parameter set, labeled by the mass, but also by the coupling constant. This would allow us to define non-trivial quantum fields, the quantum field theories as flows away from flows away from free points. Okay? I want to emphasize again that it happens to be a fact that in four dimensions, all classically relevant operators are just masters. Masters. Okay? So suppose we were in four, this is not true in six dimensions, but if we were in four dimensions, okay? If you take the statement that quantum field theories are defined as flows away from the fixed point by relevant operators, and you looked only for classically relevant operators away from free fixed points, you would only get free theories. Because it's only mass terms that are classically relevant. However, in four dimensions, there are theories. There are operators that are marginal, classically marginal. And then it's a very important question about whether these operators, these classically marginal operators, are classically relevant or classically irrelevant. If they're classically irrelevant, that happens to be the case as we will show for the 5.4 theory. Okay? Then, we only all our work in this theory if we're purists. We really want to define quantum field theories, lambda goes to infinity and that. If we're purists, all our work has been in vain. There's no such theory. It's only the free theories. On the other hand, if they're classically relevant, then we get new theories. Theories labeled by coupling constant that could do something interesting. Okay. Now, it turns out, as we will see, it turns out that 5 to the 4 theory, the marginal operator, is classically irrelevant. In QED, the marginal operator is classically irrelevant. Okay? It was this understanding in some words, not in these words, but this understanding in some words that led the deep thinkers of the time, like Landau, to conclude that classical operators being classically irrelevant was a generic feature of quantum field theory. He had a physical argument, by the way, for this. Something to do with screening. We discuss this when we complete the beta function. You see, it's totally wrong. Physical argument is totally wrong. Okay. It's a very dangerous argument to make physical argument. But, you know, what sustained him, of course, was the fact that every time you did a calculation, you found this was the answer. You found a pattern. And then you had physical arguments. You know, so, quantum field theory was there, there had to be merit. But to be honest, okay? It's a widely held view in the 1960s. Okay? At least in some parts of the world. Okay. Now, what changed, what really resurrected quantum field? Certainly as a description of quantum physics, was the discovery of one free fixed point about which the operator was marginally relevant. And that is non-abelian gauge theory. In the non-abelian gauge theory, we have 1 by g squared, various x squared. And this g here is a marginal, a classically dimensionless, therefore classically marginal operator, coupling. And it turns out that when you do the calculation for this one, when you do the calculation for this particular, when you do the calculation for this particular parameter, you find that the operator is marginally relevant. Okay? And our theory is defined by where on the flow we are at some scale. Okay? We can be quite far away on this flow at some scale. Which means we have quite strong coupling. Okay? So these QCD, non-Hermitian game theories, are paradigmatic examples. Are paradigmatic examples, right, of well-defined non-trivial quantum field theories, defined as flows away from free fixed points. Okay? And because it's a flow away from a free fixed point, flows away from free fixed point can be constructed, at least in the neighborhood of the fixed point, in perturbation theory. You see, perturbation theory will fail when you go far enough away. Because this parameter is coupling constant. You go far enough away, perturbation theory. But in the neighborhood, you can always, around a free fixed point, you can always construct the flows in perturbation theory. You can control the flows. Okay? So, okay, right. So, we try to understand in general the structure of flows by fixed points. We specialize to free fixed points. When we look at free fixed points, just simple dimensional analysis tells us that we often have classically marginal operators. Okay? These operators could turn out to be either marginally relevant or marginally irrelevant. Okay? And that, while in many cases they turn out to be marginally irrelevant, therefore do not define good quantum theories. In some cases they turn out to be marginally relevant, do define good quantum theories. And that is the case of ordinary QCD. Okay, so in some sense, non-Hermitian gauge theories in four dimensions are the only examples of well-defined quantum field theories that we can define starting with the crutch of perturbation. Okay, let me say two, three more things before. The first thing I wanted to say, yeah, class, I'll stop in 2 minutes. The first thing I wanted to say is
some other higher order as well.
We could consider such a thing. But you would of course have to find a theory in which that would be.
Yes, but in general we could not.
This is possible.
But this is physical for many theories.
In perturbation theory.
Yes.
See, firstly, even having a marginal operator,
yes,
is a very exceptional thing. Why should an operator have dimension 4 exactly? Okay.
We find that in a number of theories.
We find that in a number of free. QED is also free. You see, all these theories are defined as around the fixed point is a free fixed point.
Yes.
Okay? Now, free theories are of course very exceptional theories. Operators are given by dimensional analysis, are either integers or half integers. Then it's not so surprising that you get 4. 4 is a nice integer. Okay? However, if you look at interactive fixed points, we will study some of these. Okay? There is no, it would be quite a coincidence to have a dimension 4 operator on an interactive fixed point. See, in general, dimensions of operators will be some irrational number. For it to be exactly 4 is quite a coincidence.
An example of this.
Okay, so an example of this, although we will study it in 3 dimensions, is the Wilson-Fisher fixed point, the fixed point that governs perimeter. We will study this immediately, the next item on my list was to study this. Okay? Yes?
If we are close to the fixed point, then I can approximate the equation with expansion in X4 and with a sign with positive or negative, or that depends on the situation. I mean, the equation I have written, dx4 dt is equal to something. Proportional to x4.
Yeah.
And the sign in front of it is depends on the that will determine whether it will be marginally relevant or irrelevant. But if I take the exact equation for marginal case and try to, what will be the sense of renormalization if I want to do it exactly? I mean, not by expanding in for small. And if I am really at a distance from the fixed point, let's say.
You really
will be non-linear, non-perturbative sense. But what will be my
take? No, this is not even non-perturbative. It's just different. You see, we want, whether in perturbation theory or outside perturbation, we are defining quantum field theories by taking a UV cutoff to infinity. in order for that to be controlled, we want to be near some fixed point. So let us go back. Quantum field theories are defined. Okay? Quantum field theories are defined by flow to some fixed surface, okay, by taking a UV cutoff infinite. Okay? And the way we get that is by being near a fixed point and its margin and its set of margin relevant flows. Okay? So it's part of our basic definition of quantum field theory. That no matter where we start off in the UV, we will always end up near some fixed point. Or near the fixed surface of fixed point. So this is not about perturbation. For that reason, so what we want is to understand the surface of theories generated by flows away from fixed points. Okay? And for that understanding, it's very important as in an absolute mathematical sense, to expand around the fixed point. Because the space of flows around the fixed point is characterized by the tail expansion. So there's no approximation. Is this clear? Okay? Let me say one or two more things. This, of course, is very unreliable, but here's some intuition for us. Suppose we have the kind of flow for x one that was like the phi to the 4. So you remember what we supposed was the x form is equal to 1 over t plus a constant. Okay? On the other hand, this was in the case of, let's say, fine. On the other hand, when we look at the other side of the beta function, let's say the schematic form is 1 over minus t plus t. Just because t goes to minus t. Okay. Now, let's study this. You know, we're only doing this to one loop. Okay? The actual beta function as we go along the surface changes. So it's not reliable, what I'm saying, but it gives you some feeling for what might be. Let's look at what happens to this. So suppose here we've got some positive constant. Then let's we take t to plus infinity. Okay. As we take t to plus infinity, okay, as we take t to plus infinity, this quantity just goes to zero. On the other hand, here, if we've got some positive constant, then we can't really take t to plus infinity. Because when t gets c, this guy already proves it.
But it begins at minus infinity, so both blow up at some point.
Both blow up at some point. Exactly. But in the flow to the IR, okay, what's happening here is that as you keep flowing to the IR, according to this one loop equation, which is not reliable, at some fixed point, we've got a blow up of current. Right, it begins at t equals minus infinity. And if you go towards the IR, hang on, I'm going to talk about this point. This one. As you go deeper and deeper into the IR, there's some lower scale, some scale that is low enough so that the coupling constant blows up at that point. Okay? The scale at which this happens is a distinguished scale. It's called lambda QC. It's the scale at which, according to the one loop beta function equations, which shouldn't be abused, but according to the one loop beta function equations, the coupling would have blown up. Okay? It's an estimate of the scale at which physics becomes strongly coupled. And it's clear that physics is getting more and more strongly coupled as we go to lower and lower energies, as we're going away from the fixed point. Okay? And when we get to scales of order lambda QCD, okay, that's an estimate of the scale at which physics becomes strongly coupled.
Does lambda QCD define when QCD becomes non-perturbative, not how X4 blows up? I mean, X4 just becomes more than 1 or it's the non-perturbative.
If you want to present, this is one precise definition. Now, of course, if you took lambda QCD by 2, it would be of order 1. You see, in the one loop approximation, it actually blows up at some point. Okay. Now, if it blows up, if you want to say when it's when QCD is order 1, it will differ from the scale by a number ordering. It won't make much of a difference.
No, I'm saying the definition is different. You're defining it as lambda QCD as the scale at which X score blows up.
Yes.
Defining it, or these X codes define it as X score, lambda QCD is the scale at which X score becomes greater than 1, or I mean exceeds the perturbative regime. So,
exceeds the perturbative regime is not a very precise thing.
Agree,
so suppose you want to assign a particular number. Okay? What I've said is something precise, but you said something not very precise. But these two numbers will differ by order 1. So if you want an estimate of your scale, these are equivalent. You see, suppose you want this. Okay. Suppose you want this to be order, I don't know, 1. Then you would be solving the equation. Minus c plus c is equal to 1. Okay, I would be solving the equation minus c plus c is equal to 1. What is the change, the difference in d? It's 1. So your lambda QCD and mine would differ by e. Okay, but 1 is arbitrary while infinity seems less arbitrary. Okay, I'm saying if you're interested only in qualitative things, it's the same thing. Okay, on the other hand, here. Okay, if you look at this guy, there is also a blow up, but when t goes in the opposite direction. Okay? You know, so as you go to the ultraviolet, as you go to the ultraviolet, the coupling constant blows up at some finite scale. Okay? And, so if you worked according to the formulas of one loop renormalization, okay, you would find that it is impossible. Okay, you would find that it's impossible to maintain the condition that you stay at a fixed coupling constant. Okay, while taking lambda naught to infinity. You'd find that it's impossible to maintain the condition that you stay at a fixed coupling constant by taking lambda naught to infinity, even if you allow yourself to do something unnatural. Okay? Because once there is a certain separation of scale, so if you are at a fixed coupling constant at some scale lambda, there is some other larger coupling constant scale, finite but larger, at which the coupling constant goes up, and then the equations don't make sense at higher than that. Okay. So, QED, or the spike spot theory, is an example of a theory in which you cannot continue, at least in this one loop approximation. Example of theory in which you cannot continue the renormalization group flow equations all the way to infinity if you start with some fixed coupling at a finite. Okay. This is another indication of the triviality of these things. So you can continue to infinity, but only if you start with coupling equals zero. And then it always stays zero. Okay. The statements I've made in the last 5 minutes are just meant to be intuitive. Okay? Because they're not precise because they're based on using one loop equations. Where they're not valid. Because where a coupling constant blows up, you should be using higher order terms of beta function equations. Okay? So it shouldn't be taken too seriously, but I thought I would just say it to give you some rough sense of what's going on. Yes?
Why would you mean saying that things blowing up in the river flow are a sign of non-triviality at higher energies?
No, it's the sign that the theory is not autonomously defined. You need new physics to define it.
Okay. That's very good.
Yeah, so that this is not by itself a well-defined theory. Could be an effective theory, but only if some new massive particles come in at that scale. Atom before that scale.
For example, QD.
For example, QD is an example. Okay, let's stop the class. Yeah, we need an extra class this week. Does Wednesday work for you people? Wednesday at the usual time.
Afternoon. 10 o'clock.
Yeah. Okay. Let's. Okay. So Wednesday, what we will try to do is to get a little more serious about this stuff. We will try now to construct. We'll first check the beta function equations of IT4 theory. We'll do a calculation on that, and then we'll try to construct one non free fix. Okay. Very good. Unless it's all illegal.
I'm not sure you turned it off.